welcome you to this meeting of our special men's meeting, and we're asking God to guide and help us in a very wonderful way. I want you to stand with me, please. It's thrilling to see what the Lord is doing. In this meeting, unlike other meetings, we have assigned subjects, and we want to intensify what we're dealing with, so we just talk about the same thing in a little different aspect over and over and over. Our speaker for this hour was James Zinker, and James is still under the weather. He plans to speak tomorrow, God willing. So we changed things around so that Max could be the speaker today, so you'd be praying for him, that God will bless him and use him in a very special way. We want to welcome the friends who are joining us as we live stream the meetings. All the meetings are going out, and we're hearing such wonderful reports from people, different places around the country, and how they've been blessed and encouraged. And Mr. Thomason was just talking a moment ago about how we need to get all this information about the Bible out to people, teaching and preaching the Bible around the country, and they'll be blessed and encouraged by it, I'm sure. Would you join with me in prayer, please? Let's pray together. Our Father, as we come to Thee, we come with grateful hearts, open hearts, ready to receive what is ours to receive this day. Teach us, show us, help us as we seek after Thee. May we all decide now that we're going to be obedient to Thee. Show us Thy way. Bless our speaker, bless the music. May all of it bring honor and glory to Thee. May we pause in our hearts to recall Thy goodness to us, Thy blessings on our lives. We thank Thee for the measure of health that we have at this moment that allows us to be in this meeting. And we pray that we shall give all of that to Thee. Now take this meeting where it pleased Thee for it to go, and we'll give You glory for it. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's begin with a wonderful hymn while you're singing, hymn number 261 at Calvary. We'll join in together, all of our hearts singing, as Dr. Thompson comes to lead us.
There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Let's join and sing it.
Years I spent in vanity.
Thank you. also welcoming a number of pastors and Christian workers, in fact, hundreds of them who join Pastor Sexton every week in the Shepherd Summit at this time on Tuesdays. And we want to encourage them, and we trust they'll be greatly blessed by this meeting as well as they're tuning in. And the audience, thank you. You may be seated. And the Crown College Choir is singing now, and we thank God for them. Let's listen carefully as they sing about the Lord.
We trust.
marvelous. The Crown College Choir has had the opportunity to sing in so many places and planning a great spring tour, and we're looking forward to that. They'll be singing all the selections they presented during this special men's conference on Sunday evening in our evening service, and so we're praying much for all of that, that God will bless them and use them in a special way. I want you to find, if you would please, another hymn we're going to sing, hymn number 325, Sure to Goodness and Mercy. And I want to say, if you brought a visitor with you, and some of you did, I want to give you a copy of this brand new book, brand new, on the book of Ezra. It's subtitled, Leading the Return to God. And I'm praying that the Lord will use this book in a mighty way. I'm really more excited about it than anything I've written in a long, long time. And may I say to all of our pastors and leaders who are watching and have joined in for the Shepherd Summit, I'd like to send you a free copy of this if you'll email me and ask me for it. And I want you to have it. And I'll tell you more about that and send some things along with the email. But I want you to have a copy of this book of Ezra. It's just entitled Ezra. It's 13 chapters, nearly 300 pages long. And I hope it'll be a blessing and encouragement to you all around. If you're visiting with us, we're delighted that you're here today. And I want to give you a copy of this if you are someone's guest today. But let's stand and sing this song as Dr. Thompson comes to lead us. Do our very best.
What a wonderful hymn, 325. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Standing as our men are coming to receive the offering. I'd like to ask Dr. Bob Patton to come be ready to lead us in prayer. I wanted to mention that we're all blessed and helped by the testimony of Judge Don Layton last evening in the evening meeting, and it was such an encouragement to see how the Lord's worked in his life. And that testimony is available on Faith for the Family YouTube channel, and we trust that many can view that and hope you'll see that yourself again and pass it along to others. We know that can be a great blessing and a great encouragement. As we receive the offering in a moment, Silvian and Jonathan will be playing My Jesus, I Love Thee. It's hymn number 298, if you'd like to follow along with a familiar hymn. And let's listen carefully as they play. Dr. Patton is coming to lead us in prayer.
Before he jumps right in, Dr. Patton is celebrating a special birthday. He's 84 years old today. And, of course, he's a cardiologist and gave his whole life not just to medicine but to the Lord to serve as a missionary. As a child, he was in a Japanese prisoner of war camp for how long?
38 weeks. 38 months.
38 months. And you still have memories of that, I guess?
Toward the end, yes.
Yeah. But anyway, we're thrilled that he's here on our faculty. And I don't want him to go without having us sing happy birthday to him on this special day. Let's do it together. Are we ready? Are you ready? Together? Happy After he leads us in prayer, we're going to have a special offertory number. Silvian is going to be playing for us, and we're excited about that. He's accompanied by Jonathan, and may the Lord use them in a special way. Doctor, would you lead us in our prayer?
Let us pray. Father, we do thank you that you are the God of the universe, that you have made everything, you have all power, you know everything, and you don't need our help, but we surely need your help, and we thank you that you have given us the opportunity to participate and to be able to give back a small portion of what you have given us. And so, Father, we pray that you would place your blessing on the offering, and Father, that it would be used for your work, for the gospel to be spread, for disciples to be built. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
wonderful. Silvian, Tomescu, and I'll tell you, now this coming Lord's Day, let's have the same number so all of our church can hear it. Except, Jonathan, I'd like for you to play the pan flute and Silvian play the piano. You think you can teach him between now and then? You'll try, right? Wonderful job. Thank you. I've been looking forward to that. Thank you so very much. Well, I asked three men to speak in the morning sessions, and they all helped me here, and they serve in a wonderful way, doing special things to help our church and all of our people. Max Llama is speaking for us this morning. He was scheduled to speak Wednesday morning, but every theme is on the Bible. We started with America and the Bible, and we're going to have Mr. Zinker, God willing, speak tomorrow on the world and the Bible, and we'll have a beautiful piece to give you about world missions and evangelism. But today, children and the Bible. And Max and his wife, Madison, help us in our children's ministry. And our children's ministry is far-reaching. In our Sunday school, we have what you would normally see in a Sunday school. Then we have a second hour of Sunday school for the Judea and Samaria. We have a second coming of the Sunday school for Bible classes that are taught off this property during the week. And we did have up to 165 different classes being taught. And then we have something brand new that God is blessing in a great way, called the Global Sunday School. And that is something the Lord has put his hand on and touched in a big, big way. And our young people here lead the way in that. But there are people enrolled in the Global Sunday School all across the country in different places around the world. And Max and Madison are heading all that up. And they have developed a curriculum guided by the Bible and the Lord and the Holy Spirit for the Global Sunday School, and also a curriculum for our young people here. Can you imagine one couple reaching hundreds and hundreds of young people? Now, they've got a great team helping them. And they've started a Brave Boys and Girls Club, Bible memory workbooks, 25 different levels in Bible study, and they've got kids eagerly attacking that and conquering it and putting in a foundation for life from the curriculum they've developed. And I've never been more pleased at what God is doing with our children through these people. Thank the Lord for them. And he's going to bring the Bible message in just a moment, so you be praying for him that the Lord will use him in a very special way. And we have this girls' group coming to sing. I'm not going to tell any secrets on anybody, but we're sure happy to have you. God bless you. Amen. We're praying for them. They're going to sing, then Max's going to come and preach. I say secrets. Come here, girl. You know, this girl's been here since she's born. I saw her when she's just about this tiny. And we took a trip together in the senior trip. You think you can sing if I tell this story?
Yes.
You might. Hmm. And we got a picture sent to us from England from one of our couples there that had a baby. And it was a strange-looking picture because this handsome young man had all his hair standing straight up all over his head like he'd put his finger in an electrical socket or something. And she meant to say, when she saw the picture, she was with us, she knows the couple and we were all praying for them. She meant to say, are they going to keep his hair that way? And instead she said, are they going to keep him? In other words, he looks like that, are they going to keep him? And so I have given her the hardest time about that from that day till this, about the fact we're going to keep her. And we're going to keep all the rest of them. But we're happy you're doing. I'm glad you're doing so well. Thank the Lord for you and for your family. And I'm glad you're singing in this group. God bless your girls as you sing.
Mm-hmm.
heart, I humbly seek you. Now use my life, O Lord, I pray. I yield my stubborn will completely. May your commandments light my way.
Amen. Let's take our Bibles this morning and turn in the New Testament to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter number 3. And we'll be in 2 Timothy chapter 3 this morning. I believe this is a familiar passage to many of us today here in 2 Timothy chapter number 3. And while you're making your way there, I just want to say I'm grateful for this opportunity to bring the Bible message in this morning service. And I'm sure all of us are in agreement that God has used these meetings we've had in the last several days in a special way. And I know that I feel now more than ever a desire in my heart to be a faithful man and to build my own life upon the Bible and to make sure my family is building our family upon the Bible and to try to help as many people as I possibly can to build their life on the Bible. And I've been so stirred and so helped. And hasn't the music been a blessing? What a soul-stirring music we've had all the way through, every group and every person. I've been so blessed by that. And I know that you have as well. When we come to this passage in 2 Timothy, we know that we're coming to the final letter that was written by the Apostle Paul, and it was addressed to someone that was his son in the faith, Timothy. And at the time of writing this, the Apostle Paul was not a young man. As a matter of fact, he was getting ready to face death himself in just a short time. And even Timothy was no longer a young man. Timothy himself was now aging, and he was very experienced. Timothy had now become one of the leaders in the first century church. And God had used him to help the Apostle Paul, to start churches, to preach the gospel. And he was one of the ones that God used to turn the world upside down. This mighty man of God, Timothy. But in this passage, God reveals something to us. That the man of God that Timothy had become was connected to things that were placed in his life when he was just a little boy. It's amazing that people took the time to teach young Timothy as a child things about God and things about the Word of God. And those very things were the things that God used to make him a mighty man of God and a Christian that was a part of the first century church moving forward and advancing for the Lord. And so I want us to look at it together. Would you look at it with me? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, the Bible says, beginning in verse 14, "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." I'd like to, for you to notice with me in the 15th verse, just this phrase. The Bible says, "And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures." And this morning the subject is the Bible and children. The Bible and children. In my Bible, I have a circle around the word in verse 15, child. And I have a circle around the two words, Holy Scriptures. And a line is connecting them. We have a child and we have the Holy Scriptures. And so this morning we're talking about the Bible and children. Now, these are two vast and grand subjects. Think about it. On one side here, we have the Bible. It's the Word of God. God has spoken, and we have a record of God's words. Often when I'm with children, I do something like this. I open the Bible to a page, and I say, "Look, do you know whose words are on this page of the Bible?" And they say, "Those are God's words." Then I'll open to another page and say, "Do you know whose words are on this page of the Bible?" Every single word you see, these are God's words. This is the Bible. It's the Word of God. And it's the eternal word of God that liveth and abideth forever. It's amazing. God has spoken and he's recorded it for us in this book. There's many wonderful things we know about the Bible. We know, of course, that there is divine revelation. The Bible speaks of many different things, of places in history, of wars and battles and experiences. But the great thing about the Bible is that it reveals God to us. If you want to know about the true and living God, then you open up God's word. And it's a divine revelation. We also know of the truth of divine inspiration. That means that the very words of God were breathed by God. There was one Bible teacher who said, whenever you're reading the Bible, God is so near to you, it's like he's breathing in your face. Because these are God's words. It's the inspired word of God. Not only that, we know the truth of divine preservation. That every word that we have in the Bible today are the words that God wants us to have. God has kept his word through the centuries, and exactly what he wants us to have today, we have it. The word of God is available in 2022. We can trust it. We can believe it. We know the truth of supernatural illumination, that no man can understand the Bible without the help of God. And we have God's Spirit. He turns the light on for us. He helps us understand the truthful things from the word of God. This is no ordinary book. This is an amazing book. It's the Bible. We could speak about it, not just for 20 minutes, 30 minutes. I mean, you can go on and on and on. Not one person has ever exhausted the Word of God. G. Campbell Morgan is a famous Bible teacher of the past centuries. And he compiled in one of his books, Keys to the Word, a list of illustrations that the Bible uses for itself. And I'll read you just a few of them. The Bible is a mirror. It helps us to see ourselves as we are. And what we could be. The Bible is a laver. It washes and cleanses us from sin. The Bible is a lamp and a light. It guides us through life. The Bible is our milk and meat. It's all that we need for spiritual growth God has given to us in the Word of God. The Bible is fine gold, meant to enrich every part of our life with heaven's treasures. The Bible is our sword. It's what we use in spiritual battle. And the Bible is seed to be planted and to be spread everywhere so that new life can be born. This is the Bible. The Bible is all of this and so much more. And so this morning on one side, we're thinking of the Bible. Do you know the Bible? Do you know what the Bible is? Is the Bible important to us? This is the Word of God. We're talking about the Bible. And then on the other side of it, not only are we speaking about the eternal Word of God, we're talking about children. All of us at one time were children. Maybe even some of those who are listening at this moment are children right now. And I really cannot help but smile when I speak and think very long about children. because it's a very special time in one's life, isn't it? Childhood. Childhood is so wonderful. It's a short season of life, but such a special season of life. Children's lives are characterized by excitement and energy, a lot of energy, a whole lot of energy, and joy and discovery. They're constantly discovering things and learning. But the amazing thing about children is that they are so impressionable. It's like you almost have to handle them with care, like a box that would read fragile, handle with caution, because someone has said that children are like wet cement. Every touch leaves a lasting impression. They're just waiting to be molded. Their story has not yet been told. Many of us have made decisions. We've come somewhere in life's journey, but for a child, they're just beginning. There's no telling what one child could become and what one child could do. And so you think of children. I think when I was a boy, I remember growing up, and I'm the oldest of four. And I have three younger sisters, and their names are Tatiana, Talia, and Talissa. And two of them have come to Crown College, have studied and completed, and are serving the Lord today. And one of them is here, still a student, learning about the Lord and serving the Lord. But I remember when we were back in Key West, Florida. And I remember when we were just children in our home. And the special days that we had, and the picnics, and the special moments with our families. And I remember the things that people taught us about God. And I remember the people who were kind to us and helped us. I remember the good things and the difficult things that we faced. I remember being a child. Do you remember? Do you remember what it was like to just be a little boy or a little girl? It's an amazing thing, isn't it? Now God has allowed me to come to a place in my life where not only I was a child, but now I actually have a child. In just 2 months, my wife and I, our little daughter, will be 2 years old. It's hard to believe. She'll be 2 years old, little Evelyn. And next month, we'll have another little girl. And she'll be born into this world. And I'm not sure who's learning more, if our daughter Evelyn is learning more or Maddie and I as parents. It's an amazing opportunity to see children growing. And children have been the same since the beginning of time. They're just so tender and so innocent and just looking to learn and to love and to make friends. They're so ready to believe. And so today we're talking about the Bible and children. And you want to know something? The most natural thing in all the world is for those two things to come together. Because that's the way God designed it. God has designed in the formative years of life. There is no more fertile soil in all the world. Is anyone in here interested in teaching the Bible? Would you raise your hand? I thought that would be the case. Well, did you know there's no more fertile soil for the seed of the Word of God in all the world than little children? Go find a child. They're ready to believe. They have a capacity for faith that's just amazing. And God has designed the time of childhood to be a time when they would learn the Word of God. That the Bible would be a part of their life as they're growing, as they're developing. They would receive a Bible foundation. And so I want to share a few things with you this morning about the Bible and children. And by the way, you may be wondering, how important is this really? How big is this? This is something that the magnitude of it could not be overstated. I could not exaggerate it. Because truthfully, what becomes of children will eventually become families. And what becomes of children today is what will become of churches tomorrow. And what becomes of children now is what's going to become of nations. What becomes of children is going to become the whole world. You know, today it's about 30% of the world's population is made up of children. But 100% of the world's future is made up of children. You say, how big is this that God's design is carried out, that children learn the Word of God? It's the most important thing in all the world. And so I want you to consider just a few things with me this morning from this passage here in 2 Timothy chapter number 3. The first thing we find here in this passage is that God desires for all children to be taught the Bible. God desires for all children to be taught the Bible. Would you look with me again at verse 15? The Bible says this, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures. We find here an amazing example of the life of Timothy. And really this example of what took place in Timothy's life really is God's pattern for all children. That all children, it would be able to be said of them, that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures. That is God's intention. That's his design and his desire for all children. We know that. God wants children to learn the Word of God. And something amazing happened in Timothy's life. In my Bible, I have the word child here circled in verse 15. And also, if you look down in verse 17, the word man you find. In verse 15, we're talking about a child who someone got the Word of God to them. And then the end product of all of that, the Bible says that the man of God may be perfect. In other words, when you think of children, I mean, just think of a child that you know, that you've seen, and you say, what would it take for this child to grow up and become a man of God? What would it take for this little girl to grow up and become a woman of God? God connects the two in this passage. It's the Bible in that child. It's getting the Word of God in them. When they grow up with the foundation of God's Word, and as they're growing and as they're developing, that's how they become what God intended for them to be. And that's how they get to the place where they're equipped to do what God created them to do. They must get the Bible in their life. In every stage, in every season of life, they must be learning the Bible. That's God's desire. That's what happened with Timothy. That's how Timothy went from being a child to a man of God and a mighty soldier in the Lord's army. It was what happened with him when he was a child in the Bible. And you see, there's so many things that we can say about childhood, but one of the most dominant chords in childhood is learning. Children are learning. That's what they're doing. They're discovering things about the world. They're constantly just learning and learning. Children have to learn to walk, to talk, to think, to write, to read, to play, to make friends, to get dressed, to do everything that people do. Children have to learn it. That's the way God designed it. I'll never forget standing in the hospital the day after my wife and I's daughter Evelyn was born, and I learned that day how much children actually have to learn, because it was the day after she was born, and the nurses came in and they said, she's not growing quite like she should. She's been losing weight, and she's not keeping her weight like she should, and she's not eating properly. And I thought, well, this is strange. Certainly eating is the most natural thing in all the world. Well, nurses had to come in and take a little tiny syringe with just a few ounces of milk and literally tilt our daughter's head back and physically open her mouth and squirt drops of milk into her mouth. I thought, this is unbelievable. People are born and literally learning have to learn how to eat, the most basic things. That's a part of childhood, is just learning how to walk and to do life, to take care of your body, to brush your teeth, to get dressed, and to follow your family, and to understand the way the world works. But would you look here, please? Just as children must learn the basic things of life, they must learn what it means to be alive and care for themselves and eat and walk and talk, and children must learn to read. They must learn to write. God's intention is while they're learning all of those things, someone or someones would also be teaching them the Bible, so that in every season of life that's being built upon the Bible, and they turn the corner and there's a new things they can do, new adventures, new discoveries to be made, and there's new difficulties for children to face. God intends that when the difficulty comes, they're receiving the new strength they need from the Word of God. When the new trials come into their life as they're making discoveries, that they would find the virtues needed from the Word of God to face those trials. As children are developing and exploring and learning about the world, and questions arise in their mind. And they begin to wonder about themselves. They begin to wonder about this world and God. God's design is that the answers from the Bible would accompany those questions. They would be growing up with these answers. They would be building their life on the Bible. That's how you go from getting a little boy. That's how you go from getting a precious, beautiful little girl and they becoming a man or a woman of God. They have to be learning the Bible. There's a few verses we know that the Bible tells us this all throughout the Bible. This has always been God's intention. Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. We know what that training consists of. It's Bible training. In Isaiah 54 and verse 13, the Bible tells us in Isaiah 54 and verse 13, and all thy children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children. Isn't that amazing? And in Psalm 78, if you take the time to turn there with me to Psalm 78, this is a very well-known passage when God is instructing the nation of Israel, his people, that as they are learning the truthful things of God, as they are seeking to obey God's command, there's one other thing they must do. There's one other thing that is a necessity. They must teach the things they know to their own children. Would you look and see what it says in Psalm 78, beginning in verse 4? The Bible says, "We will not hide them from their children, showing to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wonderful works that he hath done. For he hath established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers, that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who should arise and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments." You see, there's no question about it. We know the answer. Don't we know the answer? Look, there's children in America. There's children in Africa, in Asia, in Europe. In every place where people are living, there is children. You say, well, what does the God of heaven and earth want for those children? You know the answer as well as I, don't you? He wants them to be learning the Bible. Children everywhere being taught the Bible. Taught the truth about God and who they are, about heaven and hell and Christ and sin. But you know the sad reality, don't you? Many children, if not most children in the world, are not learning the Bible. What a tragedy. Children are growing up in God's design, the one who made them, the one who knows their purpose for existence and the plan he has. It's not happening. They're not learning the Bible. And you know what? It's worse than that. They're learning all the lies of the devil. And the world is putting overtime. By the way, the world is targeting children. They're aiming for children. They're not even wasting their time on the older people and the adults. And they say those people are set in their ways. They're aiming their largest guns at children, trying to confuse them about the most basic things, about who they even are and what a family is. All the while, God intends for someone to be teaching them the truth. They would have the answer. They don't have to grow up confused. They don't have to grow up not even understanding the most basic things. They can know the truth of God. You know, it's one thing years ago in our country for prayer and Bible reading and things like that to be taken out of schools. That's one thing. It's public schools, and our government is running those things. But you know, it's a whole nother thing when the Bible is being removed from churches. Do you know that there's actually thousands of children in America that are coming to church every week and people don't even expect them to learn the Bible? They just think, well, you know, they're just going to get a good nap in. I better give them a coloring sheet they can doodle while the man of God is preaching or while the teacher is teaching a lesson. Or maybe we'll take them out of the church and we'll set them somewhere else and we'll have fun and play games and think of the greatest, biggest thing to do. All the while, God's intention has never changed from the beginning. He wants children to be taught Bible. You know, children can learn the Word of God. They're smarter than what we imagine. Children can get it. God has designed them that way. As surely as they can understand the most basic facts of life, they can understand the truths of the Word of God. And what we need today is a new harvest of Bible teachers, people who will determine in their heart that they're going to teach the Bible to children. You see, it's God's desire for all children to be taught the Bible. The second thing we find in this passage, if you would turn back with me to 2 Timothy chapter number 3, the second thing we find is that the aim of all Bible teaching must be salvation. The aim of all of our Bible teaching is salvation. You say, okay, I understand. It's true. God wants all children, no matter where they live or what they look like, he wants them to know about him and his word. But what are we aiming for? What are we really trying to get at? Working hard to prepare materials and curriculum and planning and preparing and teaching. What are we really hoping to accomplish? You know, the sad truth is there's many people every week across this country who stand before children and open a Bible. And if we're not careful, if I'm not careful, I'll forget what we're even doing. What are we hoping will be accomplished when we teach the Bible to children? If we have the right aim, we're aiming for salvation. You want to know why? Because the message and theme and purpose of the whole Bible is to bring people to faith in Jesus Christ. Look what it says there in 2 Timothy chapter 3. In verse 15, he says, "And Timothy, remember, you're a mighty man of God. You've become something great for God because of what people put in your life as a child." Well, what was it? In verse 15, "And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures." And what's the first and foremost work that the Holy Scriptures can do for a child? Well, they're able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. The master passion for every Bible teacher ought to be the salvation of the students who are hearing the Word of God. That ought to be the master passion behind all of it. Are the people who are listening to the Word of God, have they been converted? Have they been saved? Have their sins been forgiven? Are they on their way to heaven or are they on their way to hell? That's the master passion for someone who teaches the Word of God. You see, we're not just trying to make good people. The goal isn't just to make good citizens. The goal isn't even to make people who are biblically literate. Those are all good things. Wouldn't you agree those are very wonderful things? You know, all of those things will happen, but as a byproduct. The aim is that they would come into a right relationship with God by faith, which is through Jesus Christ. That they would be saved. You know, in Matthew chapter 18, if you turn with me there to Matthew 18 and verse 14, we find the clearest verse in all the Bible, I believe, about the heart of God for children. In Matthew chapter 18 and verse 14, I truly believe we find the very heartbeat of God for children summarized in one verse. In Matthew chapter 18 and verse 14, the Bible says, "Even so, it is not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish." It is not God's will. It's not his desire. It's not his intention that one child would die and go to hell. But you know the truth is that every single child who's alive today, would you look here, please? Every child who's alive today is either going to be a part of filling heaven or filling hell. Every child. And God says, it's not my will. It's not my desire. I've made a way through my son for every child to be saved from hell. It's not what he wants. There's many dangers facing children today. You can look up the statistics. The number of children who are growing up in fatherless homes, it's staggering. Children are growing up and there's no man around. No fathers to help and guide. You can look at the statistics and find out that children in poverty across the world, there are literally millions of children wondering, what's my next meal going to be? When will I eat again? Does that break your heart? It breaks my heart. And perhaps the worst I can think of is what's happening in abuse of children. And you read the statistics and you just want to start crying about how children are mistreated and abused. But you want to know something? Those aren't the greatest dangers facing children today. The greatest danger facing every child is that no matter what happens to them in life or what they do in life, they face the danger of the fact that they were born dead in their trespasses and sin. And if something doesn't happen, and if someone doesn't teach them the Bible and teach them about Jesus Christ who's mighty to save, teach them about the penalty of sin and the promise of eternal life in heaven, then they will die and be forever separated from the one who made them and loves them. And it's not his will that one would go. That's why we must teach children the Bible. And that's why when we teach children the Bible, we must aim for salvation. We must know that they've been converted, that they've been saved. You see, every Bible teacher must put a gospel hook in every lesson. We may be teaching about David and Goliath. You may be teaching about creation. You may be teaching about the fruit of the Spirit. You may be teaching about one of the just countless amazing, helpful things in the Word of God. But every lesson ought to have a gospel hook in it. Somewhere we ought to bring Jesus Christ to the forefront. Someone said this. They said, every road in the Bible leads to Jesus Christ. So travel down the road of that text long enough and make sure you make your way to the foot of the cross because children must be saved. They must come to know the Lord. You know, if children are never converted, not only are they guaranteed to struggle their whole life, a whole life of such potential and prospect and dreams. If you want to hear big dreams, ask children about what they want to become one day. It's amazing. Well, you know something? If they don't ever get saved and deal with their sin, then their life is going to lead to ruin. And worse than that, it's going to lead to an eternity separated from God the Father. You see, we must teach children the Bible. It's God's desire. We must aim for salvation. And the third thing I'd like for you to know is that there are two institutions that God has raised up to teach children the Bible. There's two institutions that God Himself has created and established to make this happen. You say, okay, we're supposed to teach children the Bible. That's God's desire. And we're aiming for salvation. We're aiming to bring them into an experience where they come to place their own faith in Jesus Christ and what He's done for them. Well, how's that going to happen? How does something like that get accomplished? Are we to wait around for some group of people to say, hey, we got to do something for children? Are we to wait for some organization to start to say, we must reach children and teach children? No. The answer is in the Bible. The answer is in the fact that God has already established all that is needed to get this done. And the two things is the home and the local church. The home and the local church. There's three God-created institutions: the home, the government, and the church. And the home and the church exist for this very reason, to teach children the Bible. I'd like for you to look with me, if you would, in 2 Timothy, back to where we were, but not in chapter 3 this time, in chapter 1. And if you remember, Timothy was taught truthful things about the Bible. He came into this experience of salvation by faith in Christ as a child. But who taught Timothy the Bible? Who took the time? Who was the person who opened up the Bible and taught Timothy? It was his own family. Look what the Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 1 in verse number 5. The Bible says this: when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. You say, who took the time to teach Timothy? How did he become this child who knew the scriptures, who became a man of God? It started in his own home. He had a grandmother who had an unfeigned faith. That means a real faith. A genuine and sincere faith. He had a grandmother. God even takes the time to give us her name. Grandmother Lois knew God and had real faith in God, in the God of the Bible. And she taught her daughter. God records for us her name as well. Look at it with me. And thy mother Eunice. So there was a grandmother named Lois and a mother named Eunice. And the grandmother no doubt taught her daughter. And the faith moved from grandmother to mother. And then mother taught her son, Timothy, and the faith moved from mother to son. And Timothy knew the scriptures. And Timothy was saved. And Timothy went on to live for the Lord. You see, the home is designed to be God's primary training ground for children. This is the first thing that God has raised up in the world for children to learn the Bible. It's parents. Parents are to be teaching children the Word of God. That's God's design. And by the way, that's why the family is facing the great attacks it's facing today. Because the devil knows that. He knows that the reason why God established a family and a man leaves his family and a young lady leaves her family and they come together to make a brand new family. Because one of the great purposes of that, the Bible tells us in Malachi chapter 2, is that God would seek a godly seed. That the truthful things would be passed on from parents to children. And so the devil is fighting that. We shouldn't be surprised. Back in Deuteronomy chapter number 6, we find that God instructed the nation of Israel all throughout that everything that they learned, they would pass them on to their children, that their children would get a hold of it. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, in verse 6, the Bible says this: and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. And in verse 7 of Deuteronomy chapter 6, the Bible says this: and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house, and on thy gates. In other words, God tells these parents, everywhere in your house, in your home, when you wake up in the morning, when you go to sleep at night, He says, even take Bible verses, take the Word of God and hang them on the gates and the walls in your house. Fill your home with the Word of God. Why? Because that's His first and primary place for children to learn the Word of God. It's with families. That's the reason, that's one of the reasons why the greatest way to help any child is to help their family have a truly Christian home. Because no matter what effort and energy and things we're doing to reach children, if they're going home and what happens in the home contradicts all that's being given them from the Word of God, there's great difficulty there. There's a better way. That's to work with families and help them to teach their children the Bible. And so God has established the home as one of the institutions to make this happen. It all begins in the home with fathers and mothers teaching their children the Bible, first and foremost by example and by simple instruction. And the second institution is the local church. God has established local churches to help families teach their children the Bible. You see, the Lord Jesus gave the Great Commission five times to the church. Five times he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That means that churches exist for the reason of getting the message of salvation in Christ to every person in the whole world. Well, remember what I said just a moment ago. Children make up a third of the world's population. Think about it. This is amazing. This is staggering. This means that a large part of the reasons why churches even exist is to reach children with the gospel and to teach them the Word of God. It's churches that are supposed to be teaching the Word of God and reinforcing what's happening in the home and giving them opportunities to learn about God and the things of the Bible and to grow up and have the things that God intends for them to have from His Word. You see, we don't need to wait around for some other group and say, well, this is terrible. There's millions, even billions of children not learning the Bible. Who's going to do something about it? The answer is not in something new. The answer is in us as Christians coming back to God's design, coming back to the home. The failure is in the home. And we must do all we can to encourage fathers and encourage mothers to build their own life on the Bible and teach their children. We must get back to leading the way for churches to make what they're doing all about the Bible. The Bible is the center of it all. Why? Because the greatest danger people are facing is they're on their way to hell. And the Bible has the answer. The Bible is what brings salvation, and it's what we need. You see, God desires for all children to be taught the Bible. The aim of all Bible teaching must be salvation. We must aim for true conversion. And God has raised these two institutions, the home and the church, to get the job done. And by the way, I'm so grateful to be a part of this church, because this church is getting the job done. It's amazing. It's amazing how God has placed this in the heart of our pastor, who himself was reached as a child for the first time, who rode on a Sunday school bus, and who didn't have a home where maybe the things of God were taught in a way that they could. But God has placed it in the pastor's heart to reach children. And here on a weekly basis, there's Bible clubs in every school going on to help children and young people. There's Sunday school buses that are sent out from here into every community of Knox County, even into surrounding cities. Who does such a thing? Who put such work and money and time and effort to reach and teach children? The Temple Baptist Church. It's amazing. It's a marvelous thing. But you know something, what we must all consider? It's amazing what this church is doing, but here's the real question. What are you doing? What are you personally doing to teach children the Bible? It would be nice if we could stand with the Temple Baptist Church on Judgment Day, wouldn't it? If we could stand before God at the judgment seat of Christ with the Temple Baptist Church and say, Lord, this is what we've done. But the truth is, every one of us will stand before God alone. And the only thing that will matter then is, what did you and what did I do personally about God's great desire for all children to learn the Bible, about children to come to know God through faith in Christ, about the home and the church being strengthened and fulfilling these God-intended missions. And so I just want to give you a final thought. The only time you have to do something about the Bible and children is right now. This is the only moment we have. Did you know that all of us are in a great race? When I was growing up, I loved racing. I always won. I was always one of the fastest. I raced, I would say hundreds of times, but at least scores of times. And I lost, I think I can only remember two. And I can tell you where we were and how it all happened and who it was. I wasn't very happy about it. I loved racing. But did you know that all of us here today are in a race? It's an ultimate race. Because the question is not, will children be reached? No. The question is, who is going to reach them? Who's going to reach the children? You see, the world is aiming for them. The world is coming for them. They're aiming their biggest weapons and guns and coming for them, trying to teach them things that are not true, trying to construct a life without God and without the Bible. And on the other side of that, the Lord Jesus is seeking children. The Lord Jesus is working in every part of the world, seeking children to bring salvation. So you and I live between these two calls. The world is saying, bring me the children. Let's go after the children. And Jesus is saying, bring me the children. Go get the children. And we live between the two calls. And the race is on. The whistle's already has been fired. We must go after the children. We must do it now. You know, there is hope. There is hope. Because wherever there's God, there is hope. And you know, everything that we've lost in the last couple of generations in America, and we hear a lot about it, and I've even mentioned some of it today, and we say, well, we've lost certain things because we failed to teach children the Bible. But you know, just as quickly as everything was lost, everything can be regained. If we today would decide to do the right thing with the Bible and children, everything can be turned around because that's what God does. You say, but Brother Max, there's millions, there's billions of children out there. What difference can we make? Maybe you've heard this story, maybe you haven't. There's a story of a man who was walking on a beach one day, and on that particular day, there happened to be just seemingly just an innumerable amount of starfish on the shore of the beach. And for some reason or another, they had washed up that evening, and there's just tens of thousands of starfish along the shore. And this man is walking that morning along the beach, and he looks off in the distance, and he sees a young figure. And every few moments, the young figure bends down and picks something up and throws it into the ocean. And he thought, that's odd. What's going on here? And as they walked closer and closer together, he noticed that the child was reaching down, picking something up, and throwing it into the sea. So they finally got close enough, and the man asked the child, he said, what are you doing? What exactly are you doing? And the boy looked at the man and said, you see, sir, all these starfish have washed up on the shore last night, and they're dying. And so I'm looking for the ones that are still alive. And as soon as I find it, I reach down and grab it, and I throw it as far as I can into the ocean. And the man thought, that's nice, but don't you see how many of them there are? There must be tens of thousands of starfish here. I mean, really, you can't make much of a difference. And as soon as he said that, the story goes, the boy bent down, picked up a starfish, and threw it as far as he could into the ocean. And he looked at the man and he said, it made a difference for that one. It made a difference for that one. And you know something? There are billions of children in the world, and they are needing to learn the Bible. You say, what can I do? You can make a difference for one. You can make a difference for the ones in your own family, the ones that we're ministering to every week in the Temple Baptist Church. You can make a difference with the Word of God and the Spirit of God. You see, the race is on. It's so clear God wants children to learn the Bible. He's designed the things to get it done, and we are the people to do it. We're the ones to get it done, and the time is now. You say, where do you start? Where's a starting place? How can I really get my foot in the door? Well, you can start by examining your own family. All of us have children in our family. Maybe you have a younger brother, a younger sister. Maybe you have a grandson. You have a granddaughter. Maybe you even just have a cousin. Well, start there. God has placed that child under your influence. Do all you can to love that child. Encourage them. Influence them. Teach them the Bible. You can begin with the ministries of our church. There are so many of them. So many wonderful opportunities to go out and thousands of children in need, and you can serve there. And by the way, not just serve there, but serve with all of your heart. Serve like if those children are going to fill heaven or hell. Serve with all of your might. Give everything you have to reach the children in Knoxville where God has placed us. And one day, all of us, if not already, will have our own family. And perhaps you have your own family now, or one day you will. If God leads you in that way, we'll become a mother, a father, and you'll have your own child. You say, what could be done? You can do everything you can now to be prepared to be the best mother and father you could possibly be. You can begin preparing and getting things hidden in your own heart so that you can fight the good fight of faith and have a Christian home and teach others how to have a Christian home and build their lives on the Bible. You see, it's the Bible and children. It's God's desire, and it's our duty. Let's do all we can. Amen. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the Word of God. And we know, dear Lord, what is in your heart. And I pray this morning that just there would be ones in here today that would get in their heart what is in your heart, dear God, that we would see children the way you see them, as souls who will live forever, and we would do all we can to get the eternal Word of God to the never-dying souls of boys and girls. Help us, we pray. Fill us with passion and courage and vigor. And Lord Jesus Christ, we love you and thank you for what you've done for us. And we thank you for this amazing opportunity. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
You can never replace passion. You either have it or you don't have it. Where does it come from? When God gave us the little book of Jude as a hallway to the last book of the Bible, it's just one chapter. And in the 22nd verse, it says, and of some have compassion, making a difference. For just a moment, don't think about the whole world or the masses. Think about one child, just one child, in whose life you can make a difference. It may be a niece or nephew. It may be a neighbor. It may be a younger sister. Let's bow in prayer just for a moment. I'm going to ask you to ask God to help you think of one child. One child. How many of you know who that child is? Would you raise your hand? You know who that child is. If you could design what could be given to that child, what would it be? The child in the Bible I want to thank Max for staying on subject and saying it again and again, making it clear, being himself. How many of you say, I understand what he said? Would you lift your hand? And what about acting on it? The child is not here, but you are. You'd like to come in instead of that child, in the stead of that child, and say, I'm going to take this serious. I'm going to take this to heart. I'm going to ask God to help me make a difference in this particular child. How many of you are thinking about that child? Would you leave your place and come and pray for that child and for you in that child's life? And we're trying to give everybody every tool imaginable . I want you to listen just a second. If you live, that child we trust will live and grow. And what can you do in the life of that child? I want you to pray for that child right now by name. Would you do that? No one will know but you and God. and ask God to help you in your heart to work toward doing what you can to make a difference in that child's life. And Father, help us to connect your word, to connect you with this child. We know we can't force anything upon this child's life, but help us to give every opportunity to this child by exposing them to the truth of thy word. While you're praying there, I'm going to ask Jonathan to play "Jesus Loves the Little Children, All the Children of the World." Children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they're precious in his sight. Jesus died for all the children of the world. Jesus rose for all the children. All the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they're precious in his sight. Jesus rose for all the children of the world. Jesus comes for all the children. All the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white. Precious in his sight. And the Lord Jesus is praying for them. All the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. What about your child now? Pray for your child, the child on your heart. You look this way. We'll be gone in a moment. When people are speaking here and I've had some part in their life, I'm praying the whole time they're speaking. I want them to be themselves. I don't want them to be anybody else. Thinking, just speak the truth. And you're a human instrument. Let God use you with your voice, your passion. Just speak the truth. And I believe we've heard the truth about the Bible and the child. You finished here, you may return to your seat. Thank you, Max. When you've preached, you don't understand if you haven't preached. You empty yourself. God willing, I'll be speaking this evening at 7 o'clock, so we'll be praying. I'll try my best not to speak as long as I did last night. You want to come around? We have some senior friends with us today. Yes? Good. We want you to have lunch with us. We want you to leave first and have lunch with us and tell them the pastor said you can eat there. And I don't know exactly what they're having for lunch, but you'll enjoy it. Some of your students have to get to work. You have an early shift at work. We want you to make sure that you go first and get in line. Just make sure that you have an early shift at work. We're going to stand together, may we? Let me ask all of our folks who are senior citizens who will have lunch with us today, you'll enjoy it, to slip out first. You may go out one of these doors or go towards your car and do that now. We appreciate it so very much. You may leave now. Go right ahead. And we have some students in our academy who are here. We will let you go. Good. We have half a hot dog for you. Good. Good. Enjoy yourself. The cafeteria is on the college campus. If you've never been there, we want you to find your way there. Make sure somebody knows and help them get there. Max, stay here near the front for a minute so people can speak to you. Maybe we can get Madison to come stand with you if she feels like doing that. And let's all be praying for the meeting this evening. Would you lead us in our closing prayer?
Let's pray. Father, we give you the glory for what you've done again in this meeting now. And Lord, we sense your presence and we sense the stirring of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, and we praise you for that. Help us to be, Lord, able to receive now all that you have for us. And Lord, help us to go forth from here to be greater used of you, to get the gospel and the word of God to those who are so needy and so open. So Lord, thank you for what we've heard today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.